So we'll move on to the last module, which is your sixth module. So in this we'll see phase plane analysis. So how we are going to analyze higher order systems by means of phase planes. So different methods we have in phase plane. So which is a graphical means of analyzing the nonlinear systems. Okay. So how we have different procedures, like three different methods we have for analyzing and determining the stability of this nonlinear system. So phase planes and phase trajectories. So as I told you, phase plane method is a graphical method. That is, by means of graphs we have to analyze the systems, nonlinear and linear system stability. Okay. So it can be analyzed by means of phase trajectories. By drawing phase trajectories, we have to analyze the system's stability. Then it also gives an idea of transient behavior and the stability of the system. Then we have restrictions for applying this phase plane. So it can be applied only to second order systems, and which is excited by step inputs or ramp inputs. If we want to apply it to higher order systems, we have to approximate the higher order system into a second order system, then apply this phase plane analysis. So first thing is, we'll be given a differential equation. So we know that all physical systems are represented by a differential equation, like d square x by dt square plus, this is your second order differential equation, 2 zeta omega n dx by dt plus omega n square x. Okay, so x is a system variable which has been differentiated, so x is one of the output variable. Zeta, we know that is damping ratio, and omega n is your natural frequency. So here we are going to assume x as one state variable and the derivatives as the other state variables. So we highest order is 2 here, so you have to assume 2 state variables. So x1 and x2 is the 2 state variables we have considered, and x1 is equal to x and x2 is equal to dx by dt. We are finding out the state variable, that is x1 dot and x2 dot. So x1 dot is equal to x2, and x2 dot is you have to replace your equation, first equation, and by the state variables and find out your x2 dot. Okay, now you have to solve this by applying, that is, you have to find the solution to the state equation by either by integration. Okay, so you can find out by integration find out the solution for this first order differential equation, or by means of phase plane analysis method you can find a solution to this differential equation. So phase plane is nothing but the coordinates with the state variables, like x1 and x2 axis. X1 is x axis and x2 is taken as your y axis. Okay, so that is called as phase plane. And phase trajectory is a curve that describes the state point in the phase plane. So we are describing some points in the phase plane with time as a running parameter. It's called phase trajectory. That means locus of a state. Okay, so that is called as phase trajectory. And a trajectory can be constructed in phase plane for each and every set of initial condition given. And family of phase trajectories are called as phase portrait. Okay, so different initial conditions will be drawing a phase trajectory, and so many phase trajectories together we call it as a phase portrait. So this is the phase trajectory of second order system for different values of zeta and initial condition. So here x1 of 0 and zeta equal to 0. For zeta equal to 0, the first figure, and zeta varies from 0 to 1, your second figure, and zeta greater than 1. So x1 of 0 is the initial condition. Okay. So initial condition is same here, and the zeta values are different. Okay. So this is a phase trajectory representation of a second order system. So this is a phase portrait, that is a family of phase trajectories. So for different initial conditions or for different parameters, you'll be getting a single phase portrait, that is family of phase trajectories together. Okay, so it's called as phase portrait. Then what is singular point? Singular point, we know that derivative of all state variables is zero, is called singular point. So that is x1 dot, x2 dot are the derivatives of state variables. Okay, we are equating that to zero, you get x1 and x2 value. So that point is called a singular point. It is also called as equilibrium point. Okay, so system, when it is placed on the singular or equilibrium point, it will stay there until it is undisturbed. Okay, when it is only if you disturb the system, it will move from that equilibrium point. Otherwise, it will be stable in the system. So that point is called as a stable point, or the system where it stays stable is called as equilibrium of the singular point. So different singular point may have nodal point, saddle point, focus point, center or vortex point. So these are classified based on the eigenvalues. So what is the value you're getting? If it is a real value or a complex value or an imaginary value, whatever be the values you're getting, so based on that you can classify your singular points. So this is a graphical representation of singular points. The table shows eigenvalues of the system matrix. Eigenvalues are nothing but when you find out lambda I minus A, okay, you find out some lambda values, right? So that lambda values are distinct, real, and it is negative. Two eigenvalues are negative means you can say that singular point is called a stable point, and the graph will be like this. The phase portrait with singular points will be shown as the figure. Similarly, if it is a distinct real and two eigenvalues are positive means you can say it is an unstable point, and it is just the reverse of this figure. Okay, so this table will be asked for almost 8 marks or 7 marks. Classify your singular points based on the eigenvalues or something like that. Okay, similarly, next one is we have real one real, one eigenvalue is positive, another one is negative means it is called a saddle. Okay, complex conjugate means it is called stable focus. If it is negative real part, if it is a positive real part means it is unstable focus, purely imaginary means it is center or a vortex. Okay, so the figures all you have to remember. So in linear system, we can define the stability as bounded input, bounded output. That is, when your input is bounded and your output is bounded, you can say the system is stable. Similarly, when you have zero input, if your trajectory or your phase trajectory moves towards the equilibrium point, that is a point where it stays stable. Okay, so that is called as a stable system. But in case of nonlinear system, this is not the case. You cannot define the stability clearly because we have more number of equilibrium points. So we have a region where we have some equilibrium points, and the system should stay stable within that region. So that is the stability concept of nonlinear system. So two main types of definitions. In linear system, we have only one equilibrium point. In nonlinear system, more than one equilibrium point we have. And we can determine the qualitative behavior in the state plane. Okay, so whereas here in nonlinear system, there is small deviation or large deviation from the equilibrium point. So from the equilibrium point, if there is very small deviation, we can say it is asymptotically stable. If there is a very large deviation, we say it is asymptotically stable and large. Okay, so like that, we cannot correctly define the nonlinear system's stability. So here we are going to see the autonomous system described in the state equation x dot is equal to f of x. You can say the system is stable at the origin when x of t, that is the solution to the state equation, is near the origin. And you can say it is asymptotically stable when your x of t approaches the origin at t tends to infinity. That means it takes a longer time to reach your equilibrium point. Okay, whereas it is near or far away from the origin, it may come to the origin or it may not come to the equilibrium point, means you can say it is asymptotically stable in large. So in these three ways only we are going to define the stability of a nonlinear system. So limit cycles and phase portrait. So limit cycles are oscillations of fixed amplitude and fixed frequency. We can predict the nonlinear system's limit cycles. That is, we have closed trajectories or closed curves. So if we have closed trajectories or closed curves, you can say there is existence of limit cycle. So it changes with the size initial condition. If your initial condition changes, your oscillations changes, or any parameter changes, it will also destroy or create oscillations. So this is a graphical representation of limit cycles in linear nonlinear system. So it is closed curve, and in this you can see a stable and unstable limit cycle nonlinear system. If it is converging to inside towards the origin, you can say it is stable limit cycle, and if it is diverging out, it is called as unstable limit cycle. Okay. So as I told you, it depends on the initial condition, and it is sensitive to the system parameters. And you have fixed amplitude and frequency over a finite range of system parameters. Then we have two types, that is diverging and converging, that is stable and unstable limit cycles. Then how to construct this phase trajectories? You have state equations, right? You have state equations of second order system, x1 dot, x2 dot, you'll find out. Then you have to find the slope by dividing x2 dot by x1 dot. So x2 dot by x1 dot gives you the slope of the phase trajectory. And singular point you have to find out by equating x1 dot is equal to 0 and x2 dot is equal to 0. Okay. Then you have to draw phase trajectories. There are two ways of determining phase trajectory. One is the graphical method, another one is analytical method. So phase trajectories graphically can be drawn, also analytically it can be drawn. So analytical means the slope equation should be integrated, and the resulting equation is used for constructing phase trajectories from a set of initial condition. Whereas graphical methods means we have two methods, one is isocline and delta method. Okay, so this theory part or the procedures for constructing phase trajectory problems. When I do problems, you will understand better. So first one is analytical method of constructing phase trajectory. So we have a differential equation describing the system. Okay, so that is then from that differential equation you have to find out your state equation, and from the state equation you have to find out your slope equation, that is x2 dot by x1 dot. Okay. Then the slope equation is split into different sessions of linear equation, and each session is being integrated directly to get the solution of a state equation. That is, you have to integrate each part, and you have to find out x of t is equal to. Okay. Then for each set of initial condition, you have to draw your phase trajectories. So that is your analytical method. So first you have to form the differential equation. From the differential equation, you have to obtain your state equation. Find the slope, then from the slope you have to integrate, you have to differentiate into each sessions, then each sessions are integrated, and finally you have to draw the phase trajectory for different initial condition. So the slope equation will be the function of x1 and x2. Okay, so you have to assume x1 and find out x2 for each set of initial condition. Then tabulate your x1, x2, then take a graph sheet, take x1 and x2 as your x-axis and y-axis, and join all the points by a smooth curve. Okay, so this is your phase trajectory construction using analytical method. And if you have any limit cycle, if it's a closed curve, you can find the existence of limit cycle. So here we will see the construction of phase trajectory by isocline method. So in this also you have to find out the slope equation, that is x2 dot divided by x1 dot. Okay, so it will be in the form of f2 x1 and x2, that is function of x1 and x2. So that is what we have written as f2 of x1 x2 divided by f1 of x1 x2. Okay, so now we have to find out f2 is equal to, just cross multiply. Okay, f2 is equal to s1 into f1. So this dx2 by dx1 is taken as s slope. Okay, so s1 into f1. Okay, so now we have to assume s1 value and x1 value. Okay, so s1 and x2 you have to assume and find out your x2 value. Okay, f2 is nothing but it's a function of x1 and x2. Okay, so you have to assume, you'll be getting an equation x2 is equal to s into some function of x1. Okay, so that will be your equation. Okay, so now we will be assuming s1 and x1, find out your x2. Okay, then you will be drawing the straight lines. Okay, so these straight lines are called isoclines. Okay, so the straight lines are called isoclines. So this, how will you draw, is that based on your x1 and x2 value, because your x-axis you have x1 and your y-axis you have x2. So we have already assumed x1 and found out x2. So you plot that, you will get a straight line. Okay. Now this A point is your initial point which will be given in your question. Okay, some minus 1 comma 0 or 2 comma 0 like that. Okay. So that initial point, you have to start from that initial point. So that initial point, you have to draw a line parallel to your x-axis. Okay, draw a line parallel to your x-axis. Clear? Now we have, with this line as reference, you have to mark alpha 1 and alpha 2. So alpha 1 is nothing but tan inverse S1. So S1 we have assumed already. Substitute that value, find out alpha 1. Then similarly substitute alpha S2 and find out alpha 2. Substitute S3 and find out alpha 3. Okay. So now here you have to first draw alpha 1 and the next slopes angle, that is alpha 2. Okay. So alpha 1 is nothing but tan inverse S1. So S1 slope of S1 is alpha 1 and slope of S2's angle is alpha 2. Right. So you have to take the angle of the slope where you are going to draw the angle and the next slope's angle. Okay. So that is alpha 1, alpha 2. So that is the dotted line which is shown here. So that dotted line should be extended towards S2 and these two lines, that is your P and Q is your angles which you have already taken, alpha 1, alpha 2. Okay. So midpoint of these two you have to take, that is your B. Okay. Take the midpoint of P and Q, which is your B. Then again the same procedure which you have done in this A point, you have to do in B point also. Okay. So in B point you have to draw a reference line which is parallel to your x-axis. Take two angles. So these two angles will be your alpha 2 and the next slope's angle, which is alpha 3. Okay. So alpha 2 angle I have drawn and the alpha 3's angle I have drawn. So this is the two angles which I have drawn. Okay. I have taken the midpoint of the these two points which is intersecting at S3. Okay. Midpoint of that, that is your C point. Now I have joined your A and B together, B and C together. All the midpoints I have joined. So like this you have to continue till it reaches your equilibrium point, which might be origin or something. So it goes on like this. So you can do two or three steps, two or three angles alone you can take. Maximum four angles you can take, and finally what is your equilibrium point? If origin is your equilibrium point, just bring it to the origin. Okay. So you do not take up to the origin, you have to take these angles and you need not conclude. So you can take up to 4 to 5 angles and just bring it to your equilibrium point. Okay. And say the system reaches your equilibrium point. Okay. So next we will see the construction of phase trajectories by delta method. So in this delta method we are converting the second order system, linear or nonlinear system, into a standard form like x double dot plus omega n square x plus delta of x dot dot t. Okay, so we have generally we have x double dot plus omega n square x plus some constant, right? So here we have a delta portion also, which is a very short interval of time delta is considered. Okay, so x double dot plus omega n square x plus delta. So whatever is your differential equation, you have to convert it into this form. You have to take commonly omega n square out and you have to reduce it into this form, that is x double dot plus omega n square x plus delta. So this is a standard delta equation. Okay. So here choosing of state variables is also a little different in delta method. Like x1 is equal to x and x2 is equal to x dot by omega n. So from this you have to find out x1 dot x2 dot. So x1 dot is equal to x dot and x2 dot is equal to x double dot by omega n, you get, right? So you can write x1 dot is equal to x dot, right? So that x dot can be replaced from your x2 is equal to equation. Okay, from that you can write x dot is equal to x2 omega n. Okay, so x1 can be written as x2 omega n. Similarly x double dot is nothing but x double dot can be written in the form of x2 dot omega n x2 dot. So x2 dot you have to get it from the equation. Okay, so substituting x double dot and x is equal to x1, you will get x2 dot is equal to. Okay, so from that you can find the state equation and slope equation x2 dot by x1 dot, so which is in the form of minus x1 plus delta by x2. So from this you have to find delta is equal to, in form of delta you have to write. Okay, next you have to draw graph. So now for drawing the graph, A point is your initial condition point. Okay, so this is your initial condition point, A point. Okay, now from this you have to find out your x1 and x2 coordinates. Okay, so you will be given an initial condition, some coordinates of x1 and x2. So that you have to substitute in your delta. So delta will be a function of x1 and x2. Okay. So you have to substitute that in your delta is equal to equation and find out your delta. So you have to see whether your delta is positive or negative. Okay, so if it is positive, the coordinates will be minus delta comma 0, and if it is negative, your coordinates will be more delta comma 0. Okay, so that coordinate it should be taken as your center point C1. Okay, so from this C1 and your A as your radius, you have to, the C as your center and A as your radius, you have to draw a small arc. Okay, so this arc, so you have to draw a small arc. So that cutting point, that arc, that point is small arc, and that point is your B. Okay, so in your graph you have to draw a small arc. Okay, so that is your B, and the coordinate of B, it will be in terms of what is x1 and x2. Okay, so that again you have to substitute in your delta is equal to equation, find out your delta whether it is positive or negative. So if it is positive, you have to take the coordinate as minus delta comma 0, and negative means more delta comma 0. So based on that you have to find out your second center point. Okay, second center point, and from that you have to take B as your radius, draw a small arc. Okay, so that ending point of your arc will be your C. Then again you have to find what is your, so for different for each student you will get a different value, because the arc length of the arc is not mentioned, but you have to draw a very small arc only it is given, so it can vary, so the coordinates also can vary, so I don't think all students will get the same answer. Okay, so you have to complete that up to it reaches your equilibrium point, which is your origin. Okay, so that is your delta method, finding out your delta method. Okay, so as I told you, you have to calculate delta. So you have to find out your x1 and x2 coordinates. Okay, calculate delta by substituting the coordinates of point A, then you have to find whether delta is positive or negative. Okay, so if delta is positive, means your C1 will be on the negative side. Okay, just opposite, and the coordinate will be minus delta comma 0. And if it is negative, means your C1 will be on the positive side, and your coordinate will be coordinate of C1 will be more delta comma 0. Okay, so that is where to mark this coordinate. So that is what. Then through the point A, you have to draw perpendicular lines, all not needed. Just you have to draw a small arc with C1 as center and C1A as radius. Okay, and next point you will get. Similarly, find out the point. Coordinates of that point, substitute in slope equation, find out your delta, positive, negative. Similarly, you have to continue the process. So this is your delta method.